when we looked at the sets of numbers, we said that we have various kinds of infinite sets, the natural numbers, the integers, the reals, the rationals. Some of them are discrete, some of them are dense. And the question that we asked was whether they all have the same size or there are more of one than another. So the question that we want to ask is, are there degrees of infinity? So we know that for a set, the cardinality denotes a number of elements. And if it's a finite set, we just have to count these elements. So for a finite set, there's no problem about cardinality. We just count the number of elements and we are done. We get a natural number, which is the cardinality of the set. Now the question is, what do we do for infinite sets? So let's look at the natural numbers, for instance. So when we move from the natural numbers to the integers, we added negative numbers. So clearly we have added an infinite set of numbers. We have roughly doubled the set. So is the set of natural numbers the same as the set of integers in size or not? Similarly, when we move from the integers to the rationals, we move from a discrete set where we had a next and previous element to a dense set where between any two elements there is another element. So this suggests that there should be more rationals than reals, the rationals than integers, but is that true or not? And finally, when we move from rationals to real numbers, we added a whole bunch of irrational numbers which cannot be expressed in the form p by q. So clearly the real numbers have a large number of new things which are not in the rationals. So again, is the set of reals larger than the set of rationals or not? So this study of the cardinality of infinite sets was actually undertaken by George Cantor in the 1870s. And as we have seen when we studied functions, the correct way to compare the cardinality of infinite sets is to use a bijection. So what is a bijection? A bijection is a one-to-one and an onto function. In other words, it allows us to map one set to another set in such a way that two elements are always mapped to two different elements and everything on the other side is mapped to from something here. That's the onto part. So it's one-to-one, no two elements mapped to the same one, and it's onto. No element on the right-hand side is missed out. So intuitively, what this allows us to do through this function, this bijection, is to pair up the elements from one side with elements from the other side. So I take an element on the left-hand side. Through the bijection, I pair it up with an element on the right-hand side. And because it is one-to-one and onto, this pairing actually exhaustively covers all the elements in both sides. So nothing is left out. So we have paired up everything, and therefore the two sides have the same cardinality. So this is a technique that we will investigate in order to resolve these questions about the cardinalities of the infinite sets of numbers that we have discussed above. So our starting point is the set of natural numbers, because this is the first infinite set that we have to begin with. When we start counting, we realize that there is no largest number because we can always add one. And so if we take all the finite numbers that we can use to count, we get an infinite set called the natural numbers. Now, supposing we find a bijection between the set of natural numbers and some other set X. Doesn't matter what this set is, but supposing there is a bijection, we can pair off the natural numbers with elements of X. This means that we can actually effectively enumerate the elements of X. We can take the number paired with 0, f of 0, and call that the beginning of X. Then f of 1 is the next element, f of 2, and so on. And because we are doing this and we are kind of enumerating X, we can count X in a way via f. And so we call any such set countable. So a countable set is one which can be bijectively paired up with the set of natural numbers. So when we are looking at other sets, we will first check whether they are countable, or if not, we have to argue that they cannot be counted. So let's begin with the set of integers and show that it is countable. So why should it not be countable, or why should it be a surprise if it is countable? Well, because z extends n with negative integers, right? So for every, if you don't count 0 in the calculation, for every positive natural number, there is a corresponding negative integer in z. So z is roughly twice as big as n. For plus 1, you have minus 1. For plus 2, you have minus 2, and so on. Right? So it seems contradictory that you can double a set and still have a set of the same size that you started with. So the question now is, for z to be countable, can we set up a bijection between the natural numbers and z? So let's look at z as we do on the number line. So it starts from some minus infinity and then it comes through minus 4, minus 3, minus 2, minus 1, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and continues. So we'll start our enumeration at 0. So we enumerate 0, the 0 of z as the 0th element. Then we map 1 to plus 1, map 2 to minus 1. What do we do next? Well, we map 3 to plus 2 and 4 to minus 2. So we keep zigzagging to the right and to the left. We count z by starting the center, moving right one, moving left one, moving right one, moving left one. So in this way, we could now enumerate the number plus 3 as 5, minus 3 as 6, plus 4 as 7, minus 4 as 8. So in this way, we can actually enumerate z effectively. So f of 0 is 0 as we saw. If I is odd, for example 1, then f of I is I plus 1 by 2. So f of 1, for instance, is 1 plus 1 by 2 is equal to 1. F of 3 is 3 plus 1 by 2 is equal to 2, and so on. So if f is odd, I have I plus 1 by 2, and if it is even like 2, then I take minus of I by 2. So I take minus of 2 by 2, which is minus 1. If it is 4, I get minus of 4 by 2, which is minus 2. Right? So we have actually given an effective way of assigning a position in some sense or a count to every number in Z, and this shows that the set of integers is actually countable. Now, what about the rationals? Well, one reason why we might suspect that the rationals are not countable is because the rationals we saw are dense. Between any two rational numbers, there is another rational number. Whether the integers and the natural numbers are discrete, you can always find a next number, and in the case of integers, you can always find a previous number. For natural numbers, 0 has no previous number. Every other number has a previous and a next. So given that rationals are dense and the integers are discrete, the question is, are there more rationals than there are integers? Now, there is an obvious bijection between pairs of integers and rationals, because that's what a rational is. A rational is a pair of integers P upon Q. So I can take a pair P comma Q in Z cross Z and directly connect it in a bijective way to the fraction P by Q. So every pair gives a unique rational number. Every rational number gives me a unique pair. There is no surprise here. There are no, we are not talking about reduced forms. So for example, we have different numbers like 1 by 10, and then we have 2 by 20 and 3 by 30. These are all different rational numbers. They may represent the same value, but they represent different pairs. So this is a clear bijection between Z cross Z and Q. So Z cross Z has the same size as Q. So if we are looking at the cardinality of Q, we can also look at the cardinality of Z cross Z, because if we can measure the cardinality, the size of Z cross Z, then through this bijection, Q must have the same size. There is no need to separately measure the size of Q. So instead of Z cross Z, just to make the picture easier to see, we will actually do N cross N, and then I will show you how to extend it to Z cross Z. So here is a picture of N cross N. So remember that we think of N cross N as a two-dimensional grid, and at each point I comma j, I have a dot representing the pair I comma j. So for instance, this pair is 5 comma 4, because it comes from the 5 and the 4 over here, right? So every dot in this pair, in this grid, is a pair in N cross N. Now I'm going to enumerate this in a particular way. So here is one enumeration. So you start with the 0th element as the element at the bottom left corner, what is normally called the origin. Then you enumerate the first diagonal, right? So you go from here, and then you go right, and then you go up. So you enumerate in this way. Then you continue. So you started from here, went up, then you go up there and come back down again, right? So you can slice this thing like this, right? So you can slice this grid like this and enumerate it diagonal by diagonal. So this gives us an effective enumeration of N cross N. But we can also enumerate it in different ways. For instance, we can enumerate it in these larger and larger squares. So we can start here, then finish this, then do this, then do this, then do this, and so on, right? So long as we don't miss out any point in the grid, we are done. So this shows us that N cross N is something that we can enumerate. Now, how would we do it for Z cross Z? Well, it's very simple. So if I had Z cross Z, I would also have points on this side, and I would also have points below. Right? So I would have points to the left and below 0, because I would have negative numbers. So now if I wanted to enumerate Z cross Z, I would start here, then I would do this, and I would complete this diamond. Then I would go here, and then I would go here, and then complete this diamond, and so on. Right? So instead of doing just the diagonal, I would extend the diagonal around to form a diamond. And in this way, I would start from the center and spiral out so that I enumerate all the numbers in Z cross Z. So N cross N can be enumerated as we saw, and this N can be easily extended to Z cross Z. So therefore, the set of rational numbers, though it is dense, and then it looks superficially to be much larger than the set of integers, actually both the integers and the rational numbers have the same number of elements, which is quite surprising, but it is true. So far, all the infinite sets we have seen are countable, right? Of course, the natural numbers are countable by definition, and then we saw the integers are also countable, and the rationals are also countable. So what about the real numbers? So how did we get to the real numbers? We took the rationals and then we added all these irrational numbers like square root of 2, pi, e, and so on. So Cantor showed that R actually is not countable. So let's see how this proof works. So actually he did have a separate proof that R is not countable, but later on he made another proof which is easier to present, which starts with a different set. So instead of looking at R, we will look at something which looks quite different. We will look at infinite sequences over 0, 1. So an infinite sequence over 0, 1 is just something like this. You just keep writing down 0 or 1 infinitely many times without stopping, right? So what Cantor argued is that this set is not something that you can count. So supposing you can enumerate the infinite sequences over 0, 1. Then on the right, you see some enumeration. We are not looking at a particular enumeration in some particular order. We are just saying, is there any enumeration at all? So that I can write down the zeroth sequence. So this is the zeroth sequence. This is f of 0 in some sense. This is f of 1. This is f of 2 and so on. So I have just written f of 0 as s0, f of 1 as s1 and so on. And each sequence has positions which I have written b for bits because these are binary digits 0 or 1. So each sequence has an infinite sequence of bits which characterize what it is, and no two rows are the same. They are all different infinite sequences of zeros and ones, right? So hypothetically, this table is an enumeration of such sequences. So if this is an enumeration of all such sequences, can we derive a contradiction? So this is how Cantor derived a contradiction. So he said, let's take each row and reverse the bit. And which bit do we reverse? Well, if we are in the ith row, then we reverse the ith bit. So in the first row, which is s0, we reverse b0. In the second row, so if you want to go back, so this was 0, so here we are at 0, 0, 1, 0. So after flipping, it becomes 1, 1, 0, 1, right? So what we are doing is in 0th row, we are flipping b0. In row s1, we are flipping b1. In s2, we are flipping b2 and so on. So now this gives us a new sequence which we can read off diagonally, right? The sequence consisting of the red numbers which we have got by flipping the number at the ith position in the ith sequence. What can we say about this sequence? Well, first of all, it is an infinite 0-1 sequence. But this infinite 0-1 sequence cannot be any of the rows in my table. Because by construction, if it is a row in my table, it must be sj for some j. But at position j, sj has been flipped. So this cannot be sj, because if I had sj already in my table, if the sequence is already in my table, the new sequence has the jth bit flipped. So diagonal sequence differs from each si at bi, and therefore this new sequence that I have constructed cannot be part of the enumeration. Now it's important that we have shown this regardless of what the enumeration looks like. We have not made any assumption about the order in which we are enumerating. We have said, no matter what sequence you have in mind in terms of enumeration, you would have to be able to write down the sequences one after the other in a table as a sequence of rows. However you write it down, I will be able to construct this new diagonal sequence by taking the ith bit in the ith row and flipping it. So however you enumerate it, I get a new sequence which is not part of your enumeration. Therefore, there is no possible way of enumerating 0-1 sequences. So as we said, this is not the question we asked. The question we asked is, are the real numbers enumerable? Are the real numbers countable? And what we have actually argued is that 0-1 sequences, infinite 0-1 sequences are not countable. So from here, how do we get to the real numbers? Well, it's one way to do this is to just think of these 0-1 sequences as actually decimal fractions. Now we know that we can write things like 10.3 and 6.28 and so on. So now we just restrict ourselves to writing in decimal fractions of the form 0 point something, where everything on the right hand side of the decimal point is either a 0 or a 1. So here is an example. right? So this is an example of a 0-1 sequence represented as a decimal fraction. So since each sequence is different, each such decimal fraction represents a different number. And these are all real numbers between 0 and 1, because they all have an integer part which is 0, and then we have something which is, of course, we could have exactly 0 if we have all zeros, okay? So we definitely don't have all, can't get to 1. But we can think of these as numbers between 0 and 1. So each such sequence represents a different point in the interval 0 to 1. So this is an injective function, right? So this is an injection, that is a one-to-one function from infinite sequence of 0, 1 to the interval 0, 1. Now the interval 0, 1 is a very small fraction of the reals. So what this argument tells us is that, in fact, even this very small fraction of the reals is not countable, because the set of underlying 0, 1 sequences is not countable. So if this, even the small fraction of the reals cannot be enumerated, then R itself cannot be countable, right? So this is an indirect argument saying that, not saying that R itself is not countable directly, but saying that there is a small part of R which is not countable, and since R is much more than that, if the small part cannot be counted, we have no hope of counting the whole thing. So to summarize, any set that has a bijection from N is what we call a countable set, and we showed that the set of integers and the set of rationals are countable by describing a strategy to enumerate the sets. Now this argument due to Cantor, which is builds this diagonal sequence, which is called diagonalization and has been used in many other proofs involving infinity after that. So the proof of diagonalization by Cantor shows that the set of real numbers is not countable. So notice that if the set of real numbers is not countable and the set of rationals is countable, what did we do to the rationals to become, to create the real numbers? We added the irrational numbers. So actually, the set of irrational numbers that we have added to the rationals must be itself uncountable, because we can't take two countable sets and add them up and get an uncountable set. So in other words, there are vastly more irrational numbers than there are rational numbers. That's what it tells us. Now one question that we could ask is there anything in between? So these are sets that we have been using intuitively, so we have counted them. But can we construct something, for instance, which is not countable but which is smaller than the reals? Right? So is there such an infinite set? Now it turns out that this is a very non-trivial question. So this question was actually posed when Cantor came up with this proof in the late 1800s, and it remained a very central open question. It was called the continuum hypothesis. So the question is, are there in the, just, so if you look at cardinal numbers in the finite sense, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, so we have a kind of small jumps between them, but we have a continuous sequence of numbers. Now we seem to have this big jump between the real number, the integers or the natural numbers and the real numbers. So is there something in between, or is it, so is there a continuum of these infinite numbers, or are these big jumps? And this continuum hypothesis was a very important open question in set theory, and in the 1960s, Paul Cohen actually showed that this is a question which cannot be proved or disproved. So this is what is called independent. So this is a fact which is independent of set theory. Using the axioms of set theory, there is no way that you can either prove or disprove it. So both the fact that there is such a set and there is not such a set are consistent. So these infinite sets lead to a lot of interesting questions. Some of them are quite mind-boggling and they are quite counterintuitive. But if you are interested in these things, it's well worth looking at them.